Christian friends rejoice.
Christ is born. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Welcome to the Church of the Good Shepherd. Our service begins on page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have poured upon us the new light of your incarnate word. Grant that this light enkindled in our hearts may shine forth in our lives through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you.
reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exalt in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. For Zion's sake I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not rest until her vindication shines out like the dawn and her salvation like a burning torch. The nations shall see your vindication and all the kings your glory, and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. The word of the Lord. Psalm 147, verses 13 through 21, can be found on 805 of the Book of Common Prayer. We will say it in unison. Worship the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise your God, O Zion, for he has strengthened the bars of your gates. He has blessed your children within you. He has established peace on your borders. He satisfies you with the finest wheat. He sends out his command to the earth, and his word runs very swiftly. He gives the snow like wool. He scatters hoarfrost like ashes. He scatters his hail like breadcrumbs. Who can stand against his cold? He sends forth his word and melts them. He blows with his wind and the waters flow. He declares his word to Jacob, his statutes and his judgments to Israel. He has not done so to any other nation. To them he has not revealed his judgments. Hallelujah. A reading from the letter to Paul to the Galatians. Now before faith came, we were imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to a disciplinarian. But when the fullness of time has come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child, and if a child, then also an heir through God. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Good morning.
Good morning.
So good to be with you today. In this trifecta of Christmas services, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. I love the decorations during this time of year, and it's an act of worship whenever we put up the greenery and put out the creche and make sure the Christmas tree has lights and the bell tower, and it's just a beautiful time of year. And I was thinking when we were singing the opening hymn, "Good Christian Friends Rejoice," that in that first verse it says, "Ox and ass before him bow, and he is in the manger now." Reminded me of a time a few years ago when the church I was at had a series of stained glass windows, very similar to Good Shepherd here, and there was a flat windowsill at the bottom of each stained glass window. And as Advent began and as the weeks progressed, the camels and the donkeys and the wise men and the characters had a journey around the room in the windows. And we even had a bit of a mild argument second or third week of Advent as to which window the camels needed to be in. But it was all in good fun and all for the children, and I think children of God. We all enjoyed that. And one particular Christmas, I was getting vested in the vesting room, which was also the sacristy in that church, and two saints of God, two altar guild saints, that is, stood at the doorway looking in with a little bit of consternation on their face. They said, "We've lost Jesus." I said, "Excuse me?" I said, "We can't find Jesus." I said, "Well, there's a whole lot of people that have been in church their whole life who can't find Jesus." No, we can't find Jesus. I'm sorry, I'm still not following you. We'll have confession a little later on, and you can say these things. No, the baby Jesus in the manger is missing. What? In the creche, in front of the altar, the baby Jesus is gone. Interesting. And they said, "There's a little lamb in the manger, in the place of Jesus." I thought, well, that'll preach. And evidently, some family went up to the front, we learned later, and one of the children out of the goodness of their heart, picked up the baby Jesus because she wanted to hold on to Jesus. And of course, she didn't want to leave the little manger empty, so she took a little sheet that was on the side and put it in there. I've never forgotten that. We've lost Jesus. Later, when the offering came up, we had two offering plates, one for kind of like here, one side and one for the other. And the top plate was slanted at about a 45 degree angle. And as I blessed them and took and looked under that top plate, baby Jesus was there on the pile, turned in. I loved that because there was something perfect in the imperfection of it all and the sweetness that this child wanted to hold on to Jesus. Knowing Jesus was up there was one thing, but she wanted to hold on to Jesus for a little while. A clergy friend of mine was doing a similar service with the children's pageant at his church, and when it came time to line up all the characters for the play, for the pageant, they had everybody there except for one of the kings. One of the three kings, one of the three wise men, must have come down with something. Something happened and they weren't there. And so they all gathered to talk about what they should do. And they said, well, we can cancel this because we don't have the three wise men here. Or we can just carry on, which is what they did. And when it came time for the three little wise men to come down the center aisle and sing, "We Three Kings," they changed the lyrics to "We Two Kings." And of course, everyone got it. Sometimes in our lives, there are, around the holidays, disappointments. There are things that we didn't plan on. There are incomplete spaces. And it's okay. We might feel like we lose Jesus or have lost Jesus, at least for a little while. But all the while, Jesus, of course, is here. And we might feel like we're having another Two King Christmas this year. But we carry on, don't we? And we sing "We Two Kings" if we need to. And it's because, like our scripture says today, we all want to receive God. And we need God to complete us anyway. And so it's a bit of a misnomer for us to think if we have all three kings, so to speak, we have all of our stuff together, everything happens according to our plans for Christmas, then it leaves no room to be surprised and to celebrate that we have the invitation to receive Christ again right where we are in the midst of all the incompleteness and imperfections. After all, that's why Jesus came in the midst of a violent and chaotic world, to complete, to restore. Paul tells us in the letter to the Galatians that this happens through adoption. It's a beautiful theological reality, being adopted. And John tells us in the gospel today that we're not born out of blood, but for those of us who adopt God, who receive God, that completes us. That's the way it happens. In our Book of Common Prayer, on page 439, we have a short but very poignant service for adoptive parents and the child, if they're old enough to speak. As an adoptive parent myself, I have a 16-year-old. That service is extremely meaningful. It gives the chance for the family to come to the church, and before the church community, the congregation, and the priest, there is an oath taken, a covenant made. And the child, again, if they're old enough to speak, has the opportunity to say, I choose you to be my mother, be my father. And the parent has the opportunity to say to the child, I choose you. And together they receive, and together the congregation receives the family. Because God has already received us, we can celebrate and enjoy that life, that relationship of adoption. Grace upon grace, Scripture tells us. The Scripture also tells us today about the value of light, to be a light to the world. The role of light and life go together. It's interesting that there's a scientific reality that when light reflects off something, that energy that we see or perceive, that reflection of light is only 95% of the actual light. Because 5%, which may seem small, but it's 5%. It's a reality. 5% of the light is actually absorbed into the perceiver. We absorb starlight, in other words, at night. We absorb the light from these stained glass windows. And I think we absorb at least 5% of the light of the world, Christ, in our lives. And that adds up to where we become the reflection of the Word incarnate, of God come down, of love here, walking with us. And that's how we can together teach and preach what it means to be in the image of God. As we spend our lives learning what that means, we can enjoy the fact that we can also reflect that light of God into the world to make a difference. As magical as Christmas can be, and as magical as Christmas is, it's not the magic that ultimately saves us. It's this baby sent into the world against all odds. Not in a fancy hospital was Jesus born, or in the midst of great peace, Christ comes down in the midst of chaos. Herod is searching. That's why the wise men are also sent, from the worldly standpoint, that is. But it's the light of the star that changes us. It's the light of the star that is the real magic in us, the magic of God's love against all odds. About 20 years ago, I was in New York and had the opportunity to go to Riverside Church to hear a famous clergy person speak. He had a new book coming out called God's Dream. It was a small, very influential and beautiful book because it was written by a beautiful soul. Desmond Tutu was in town, and he also came to my seminary in New York, and his daughter was a graduate. She's a priest and was also a graduate of General. And so I got to hear Desmond Tutu speak more than once. And after the event at Riverside, I got to meet him at the book signing. He's just so infectious in all the best ways. His attitude, his smile, his perseverance in the midst of chaos, violence. He knows who he is. And I love this one thing. He has so many beautiful quotes, but this one thing he says, we might be surprised who we find in heaven. Because God has a soft spot for sinners, and his standards are very low. I love that. And then his little laugh and his smile. Well, yesterday, Desmond Tutu passed away. He's in a better place. But while he was here, he let the light of Christ shine through his life. His life and ministry, interchangeable, hard to separate them. What a beautiful example for us. I keep this picture that somebody gave me of Desmond Tutu many years ago. And one of the things this is in my office, and one of the things I love about this picture, he's just sitting in a chair, chilling out. He's got that sweet smile, sweet presence, that was really indicative of his deeper joy that he had. And the reason I mention him is, of course, we want to honor him, but he was a person that didn't let the incompleteness of the world put him down. He spoke in the midst of apartheid, as we all know. He made a difference in the lives of people who literally were yelling and spitting in his face or calling him names, and those that he loved, because he had received Christ. He knew that Christ was dealing with that situation. He knew that that enemy, so to speak, was worthy of adoption ultimately as well. And so he had patience or long suffering. In our lives, we have so many opportunities to say, well, I just want to give up. I don't want to do this, or I don't want to do that. It seems too difficult. All the pieces of my plan aren't there. I can't see it. And that is exactly the point of Christmas. It's the missing kings in our pageant. It's the times when we feel like love itself is missing, when Jesus is missing, or hope is missing in our world. But then there would be no need of Christ otherwise, because he came into the imperfect world where prejudice abounds, where hostages are taken, and we hear about on the news, where famine spreads, and where diplomats in dark suits make decisions that mean life or death to our soldiers. That's the kind of world that Jesus came into and has come into in 2021. And that's precisely why he came, to bring light to all that kind of darkness. And that's why he comes today again to you and me. Sometimes we refer to the Sunday after Christmas as a low Sunday. And I don't know that any Sunday can be low, because it has to do with the light of the resurrection, the light of love that God gives us, that we do absorb and reflect. We may have our own series of disappointments in our lives, but don't let that throw us off. There is time now, and in this Christmastide leading up to Epiphany of January 6th, when the three kings come, there is time now for us to celebrate our own two-king Christmas. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Turn to page 358 in your books of common prayer. We will affirm our faith in the word of the Nicene Creed, saying together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, according with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and Son. With the Father and Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life toward to come. Amen. Prayers of the People, Form 3, begins on page 387. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. May we one. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of thy kingdom, and grant that we, thy servants who live by faith, may behold with joy your Son at his coming in his glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Turning to page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Please be seated. So good to be with you. Welcome, Dr. Clyde Beavers on cello. Thank you for sharing your gifts with us this morning. Dr. David Cooper behind the organ panel over there. So, give thanks for everybody here helping to make sure this worship service starts and ends in the best way possible. And give thanks for Diane. Thank you, Diane. Your beautiful voice. We can applaud her too. Announcements are very brief. Basically, we're just Room in the Inn is coming back. We work with other churches in the area to provide a homeless shelter here in the undercroft of this church. And if anyone would like to learn more about that and volunteer, then you can look at the website, or you can also call the church office. The church office this week, by the way, will be open Wednesday and Thursday. It's closed tomorrow, Tuesday, and Friday, just the way the holiday schedule falls. But Wednesday and Thursday, it will be open. I understand that not from the church's standpoint of things, but our website is having some difficulties this morning. I think people can still live stream and are live streaming right now through Facebook, but I think other channels, and we'll get that worked out, and then this service will also be archived like the others. I wanted to just say that Father Hendry, you may have noticed he's not here today, and he is taking a very well-deserved break with his family as they travel to see family just for the next few days. And so we want to keep Father Hendry and his family in our prayers for safety, of course. Do we have any? Oh, one other thing. So if you're visiting with us today, of course we welcome you. There are Connect cards in the pews. If you'd like to take a moment just to write down your name, you can put that in the offering plate when it comes. And if you've taken the baby Jesus from the creche, you can just put Jesus right on top. We do appreciate being able to connect with you, and we have an online Connect card that people at home can access as well. Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries in this group to celebrate today? All right. Well, any other announcements for the good of the church? Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Come into his courts and bring offerings.
Our service continues on page 367 with the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you gave Jesus Christ, your only Son, to be born for us, who by the mighty power of the Holy Spirit was made perfect man of the flesh of the Virgin Mary, his mother, so that we might be delivered from the bondage of sin and receive power to become your children. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, and the calling of Israel to be your people, and your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. And on the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us also to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Our hymn is 115. Post-communion prayer is found on page 365. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness of singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the God who came in the form of a baby, lived as a man, died as our Savior, keep you now and forever in his arms of love and peace. And the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.
The image of a mountain in Scripture has two meanings. One is the presence of God. The other is as a barrier that the psalmists refer to. When Jesus comes, it bridges heaven and earth, and there is no need for barriers anymore to connect to God. And so that's why we give thanks, and that's why we go and tell it on a mountain. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Merry Christmas. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.